So, welcome to this meeting, Professor Reinhard Genzel. So my name is Julia Ravanis, and I'm here at Chalmers University, where I am halfway through in a PhD in history of science and technology.
I see. Mm-hmm.
But I have studied physics before, also here at Chalmers, and I've also written a book, a popular science book called Beauty in Chaos, which is about theoretical physics and its connections to existential questions and human experiences.
Oh my.
So I have a big interest in astrophysics. It's a lot of astrophysics in the book as well. So that's why I'm very delighted to get the chance to talk to you, because you also have a big interest in the physics of space. You are a professor at UC Berkeley and in the States, and a director at the Max Planck Institute for Extraterrestrial Physics in Germany. And you also received the Nobel Prize in Physics in 2020 for the observation of, and now I quote, a supermassive compact object at the center of our galaxy. Something that is more commonly known as a black hole. A black hole is something very elusive, right? It's very hard to measure it. It's been, I know that in your Nobel lecture, you called this a 40-year journey to reach this conclusion that it is almost beyond doubt a black hole at the center of our galaxy. For such a long time, it was only a theoretical prediction. So how did you feel? Did you ever doubt the existence of a black hole, or doubt that you would find it?
The idea to hunt for such objects came on with the discovery of the quasars, but the quasars turned out to be so far away that the technique which we've been using for the galactic center, namely to use objects orbiting or gas orbiting the black hole to identify the central object, measure its mass, et cetera, that was not realistic. It is beginning to be realistic now, but not back then. And so in a way, observers were stuck. And then there was a very famous theoretical paper in 1971 by two British theorists, Donald Lindbell and Martin Rees, who basically made the proposal, well, maybe these quasars are just the tip of the iceberg type situation, where sometimes a black hole in the center of a Milky Way accretes a lot of material. But suppose that many galaxies, perhaps even all galaxies, have a black hole, but then most of them don't accrete that much. But if that were the case, then you could speculate that maybe even nearby galaxies, and then therefore also our own galaxy, might have such a black hole. So that changed the landscape, if you like, where to look. And indeed, in the 70s, my mentor, Charles Townes, who had gotten the Nobel Prize for the invention of the meson and the laser, in his later years at Berkeley, started doing astronomy, infrared astronomy. And he and his group, and I even became a postdoc and later on a faculty member with him, we were basically then looking at the galactic center then, but not in the stars that we couldn't do, but with the gas. And remarkably, in already 1982, 85, we published papers where our conclusion was there is a central object in the central light year, so to speak. We couldn't, you know, concentrate it much further, of a few million solar masses. So in that sense, for me, this story has been one where we knew the approximate answer fairly early on and at every stage, actually. But the degree to which we could present the proof was initially not sufficient by far. And then it got over time better and better. At some point, many astronomers started believing it. This and would say, oh, the galactic center is the best case we now have. And of course, the last ones we were able to convince are the physicists, right? I mean, they were very skeptical that we could get close enough. And in fact, there's the issue of whether general relativity holds still in this regime. So that was a matter of the last few years. But anyhow,
So was there a time when you felt that you had succeeded, where you thought that, oh my God, I'm going to get that call from Stockholm. They're going to offer me the Nobel Prize.
No. Well, okay, on that one, by the way, you know, Charlie Towns, Nobel laureate, as I said, always told me, Reinhard, look, just to so that you're sure about this, you can never get a Nobel Prize because there cannot be any Nobel Prize for astronomy. That has changed a lot, and it's a remarkable change, in part, I presume, because astronomy and its various discoveries have ever more mingled and connected up with fundamental physics. Okay, I mean, basically what we are doing is experimental physics with the difference that we don't have a laboratory around the corner, but 27,000 light years away.
Yes, and that's all about the field of astrophysics, right? The combination between astronomy and physics. But would you call yourself an experimentalist?
Yes, absolutely. I've grown up, I should say, I have a heritage in that my father was a physicist too. My father was an experimental physicist.
Okay, so you got it from childhood.
Absolutely. I grew up already in this sort of environment. And I definitely, when I started my studies then in Bonn with the idea that I might do my diploma and my PhD at the newly founded Max Planck Institute for Radio Astronomy at the time, I considered myself a physicist and not an astronomer. It was a bit of a joke all the time that, you know, physicists would all feel that they are a different brand of people. As I said, I mean,
my physics studies.
The physicists always felt, all the astronomers, they have these big numbers, but they don't really know what they're doing. that has changed. But yes, I would say I consider myself a physicist. But over time, I also appreciated the parts of astrophysics which have to do with discovery. I mean, if you go back to the black holes, it's one thing to ask the question, is this really a black hole? And if so, is it the black hole described by the Kerr-metric? I mean, that's the question which actually is not yet answered, okay? Because we have not yet measured the spin. So we're not even at the end of the story. We just can say it's probably a black hole in the sense of general relativity, spin unknown, so to speak. But, I mean, the other part of the story, which has to do with the universe, namely, what's the role of these things and how many and so forth, which I touched on, that only became possible also in the last tens of years and has become a remarkable story in that we now know, yes, almost every certainly massive galaxy has a central black hole, and the mass of the black hole and the mass of the galaxy actually are correlated. So it's a few fraction of a few by 10 to minus 3 of the galaxy mass is in the central black hole, and the two statistically co-evolved over cosmic time, started off very early on, typically say 11 giga years ago, few giga years after the Big Bang, initially small, growing from accretion of gas into the galaxy and also then into the black hole. And so both sort of statistically at least grew together and interacting with each other, because if a black hole does accrete a lot, like in a quasar, the amount of radiation and also thrown out energy is so large that it can actually stop the galaxy from further growth. So it's a remarkable story of astronomy in that sense, which has come to the fore. And of course, we still don't know, in fact, at this point, how did it start? I mean, who was the chicken and who was the egg? Yeah, I mean, it's not clear, and that's something to be researched in the next years. What was the mass of the first seed black holes in the galaxies early on, for instance?
I wonder what made you so interested in black holes. What do you find fascinating about space? Why did you choose to be a physicist and or an astronomer?
I have a heritage in the sense that my father was a physicist. Actually, my first inclination was to study archaeology. Mm-hmm.
That's when a totally different subject.
No. I would say archaeology is very similar to astronomy because both are about evolution, right? You basically, in archaeology, you dig up an old city in order to understand how that hill, how that city evolved. When did it start? What was the seed city? Yeah, same kind of, question.
That's true. You're studying objects that are distant in time.
Yes,
right?
Absolutely. So it's actually very, very much related. But then I found, in the end, I found the physics. Astronomy was not very popular in Germany. I mean, a little bit of optical astronomy, but I mean, like in Sweden, you know, that the skies are often covered and it's not clear skies. So it's not a superb place to do astronomy. But then in the 60s, as I said, the Max Planck Society opened up this new institute for radio astronomy. And I thought that might be quite interesting. And now initially I didn't work on black holes, but on star formation and how stars formed and so forth. So the black hole part came in when I joined Charlie Towns at Berkeley. That was really very clear because he had been doing this already for 2 or 3 years. And then it became sort of something which we really focused on for a while, but not exclusively. I mean, we are here in my group here. You're also studying the evolution of galaxies and other things.
When I was a child, I loved watching the stars. Like, I was very fascinated. I thought that stars were amongst the most beautiful things in the world. Then, like, as a more of a grown-up, I realized that I probably was more interested in the parts of space that we cannot see, the dark parts. For example, I wrote my master thesis in physics about dark matter, which is an invisible type of materia, an unknown type of material believed to be very abundant in space. So I was drawn to that, like the parts of the world that are not and perhaps can never be fully transparent. So I wonder, are you also drawn to that? And why do you think people are drawn to invisible objects like black hole and to the unknown parts of the universe?
Well, okay, it really depends on your motivation, I should say. Okay, I mean, there are obviously people who come very much from a philosophy or theoretical physics side, which is what you do. I'm in that sense really an experimentalist. I really tend to think about, and with my group and my team, go for things where I really feel we can make progress with new instrumentation. So it's sort of a combination. Yes, there are many, many questions. Dark matter, okay, we are actually looking at the dark matter issue at high redshift, okay? So we are measuring so-called rotation curves in high redshift galaxies to study the distribution of dark matter. And we found some interesting new things. But of course, in the way you probably are interested in it, namely to understand what is this thing called dark matter. Well, okay, I mean, then I should be doing probably underground tunnel experiments in particle physics, or maybe not. I mean, as you know, lately the speculation has grown as we have not seen the discovery of elementary particles called dark matter. That maybe it's something else. And so the hype of the day, again, is maybe it's mini black holes, which originated in the Big Bang, okay? But that one actually, although I find it highly speculative and probably won't come to naught, but that's something which potentially we can check out. Again, for the same reason, right? If there, imagine there were a few solar mass black holes, which then you could not ascribe to originate in stellar evolution. You could see that, if you like, through the action of their gravity onto the surrounding. And so if you, for instance, look at lenses, micro lenses, you could measure their masses and so forth. So that's something which I would say, if that were really getting real, then I would say, hey, let's have a look. Yeah. But that's really my motivation. Let's have a look if you have a chance to rock the boat, so to speak, to make progress in a certain field. To ask the question, what was before the Big Bang? I would say, well, okay, surely an interesting question, but none
but
of
you
us.
You don't want to solve it.
And we can't. It's just not possible. That, of course, you are right in that sense. Black holes have that part, that side to them. And that makes them both interesting for the general public, this mysterious stuff, yeah? And then, of course, the central singularity. The event horizon, I would say, is more mundane, but the central singularity, that, and then the information issue of whether there is or is not quantum information which you could at some point in time get at. That would be fantastic. But again, currently, I these are questions way out of possibility.
I agree that the event horizon is very interesting, actually. I don't think it's that mundane. And I think this picture of the black hole in the center of our galaxy that was made from the Event Horizon Telescope a few weeks ago really shows how the event horizon is a beautiful thing and not very mundane. I think people were excited about seeing that picture. But it also seems, I think you do have a point here, that I am on the more theoretical side. I am a theoretician and you are more of an experimentalist. And that's a classic divide, right, between in a way.
Julia, look, I mean, the issue with these images is very clear. And I would say the first image of M87 3 years ago was even more of a point because it came so sudden. It was the first image. And yet I might, if I'm a little critical, I would say, be careful. Just because there is a bright ring around something which is a little darker doesn't mean a black hole has to be there. Okay, so if you really sort of start off exploring the forest and say, oh, there's a bright ring with something dark in there, it must be a black hole. I would say, be careful, maybe what you're looking at is a protostellar disk of dust around a newly formed star, which has so much dust around it that you can't see any visible light from it. Okay, so that's possible. To tell these two things apart, you have to make other measurements in addition to a picture. So that's really what I would say needs to be done. Yet, indeed, this particular picture has, as I already pointed out, completed our set of proofs, because it has added yet more weight to excluding any mass distribution other than a black hole, because the shadow is so compact. Okay.
Yeah, we do need better and better measurements. But as a last question now, what do you feel is so fulfilling about making those measurements? What is fulfilling for you?
It's just exciting to do research, I have to say. I mean, I could imagine myself doing other types of research, but I find the general process of exploring and then understanding just absolutely fantastic. And
that feeling when you're getting closer to an understanding.
Yeah, you feel you're getting closer, and you if you go home, so to speak, in the evening and say, hey, today I've understood something. It's in the morning, I didn't. That's fantastic.
Yeah. I agree. I think that's why we all do research. It was amazing to talk to you, Reinhard Genzel.
Okay, thank you, Julia.
Thank you.